playing basketball, they ask you to watch the waist, because the waist can't go nowhere. You can't go nowhere without the waist. You can take it, put your arm in the water, right? But that don't mean you're in the water until you get in there. It says that you gird yourself in truth, because in John it says that knowing the truth will make you free. Meaning that you begin to walk in, it says that, and you put on the sandals, it says having your feet slow.
Stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace.
Amen. Get ready to walk out. And he tells you to put on thy garment, you know, not any garment. See, we have to put on, your garment means your eye, what people see. It means that put on the Lord Jesus Christ.
Mm-hmm.
That's what it means. Put on his mind, his character, and begin to walk out this thing. Because, and it also say, and follow me. And in Luke it say, if any man come after me, that he must deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. The cross means suffering, denying yourself, denying your flesh, and walking with God. Because it's one way out of prison.
But when you talk about the clothes, I just reminded of a story that they once told. It was two guys were given a parachute. I don't know if you heard me say it before, but two guys were given a parachute, and one was told, if you wear this parachute, when you get on this plane, it will make a good ride. So the guy halfway through the flight puts on the parachute. But he notices and he tightens up that it's uncomfortable. And everybody starts laughing at him and everything. And he finally takes it off and he says, that's the last time I'm ever going to wear one of those things. Well, the next guy is told, put on this parachute because at 30,000 feet, you're going to have to jump out. So he puts it on, he makes it even tighter, and he sits in there. He doesn't understand that, he doesn't care that it's uncomfortable. He doesn't care that people are going to laugh at him, because he knows it's going to save his life. In fact, the stewardess is a new stewardess. She pours hot coffee on him, and it burns him. And he doesn't complain to the stewardess. You know what he does? He holds onto that parachute even tighter, because he knows he's going to need it. That little burn is nothing compared to what's coming. And you see, the clothes, the garment that he tells, like you said, to put on, we got to wear Jesus.
Right.
We can't just carry Jesus.
Right.
We need to wear Jesus, because anything that happens in this world is nothing compared to what's coming. And when it comes down to it, he's going to save us.
Amen.
He's going to protect us. So we got to wear Jesus, make him part of us. Because the minute we start doing a thing by just trying it on or sampling it, and you're going to discover you're going to have tribulations and trials. Look, and you're not going to be ready. And let's say the plane did start catching on fire. The guy that threw off his parachute now is scrambling to try to find it. He can't get it. Well, the guy that has the parachute, he's already out the door. It's thanking God, I got saved.
Amen.
And you see, that's Judgment Day. He doesn't have to worry about when Judgment Day is coming, because he's ready for it. That's what when I think of the garments, that's what it makes me think.
Okay.
Being ready to wear the garments of Jesus.
Amen. I think Peter was talking about not fastening yourself in your form of ignorance.
Mm-hmm.
Meaning not putting on the new man and not the old man.
That's right.
And it talks about Ephesians talking about your mouth, filter talking, jets and coarse talking. It says not convenient, meaning it don't fit you anymore.
You're like, don't put old wine, new wine in an old container.
And then he said, put on thy garment, which Jesus Christ. He put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Get ready and follow me. We finna walk out this thing.
Yeah.
Come on.
Amen.
Yeah, exactly.
And it has to do a lot with obedience. See, any way you went into bondage, you got to go to the iron gate. We get into the iron gate now. Amen. And see, he went out and followed him, and wist not, meaning he didn't know that it was true, which was done by the angel. But through, he saw a vision, though he saw a vision. And they were past the first and the second war. Meaning I went to chapter 16, it was talking about them being thrown in the inner prison. I believe he was in solitary confinement, that's what I believe. And it said it came into the iron gate that leadeth into city. The city represents to be free, Jerusalem, amen, and which opened to them at his accord. And they went out and passed through one street and went forth with the angel, and the angel departed from him. Amen. It said that, say he came to the iron gate. The iron gate represents that thing that got you in bondage. It's where you started at. See, the only way you could go to prison, the same door you come in, most of the time you go out too. And you have to face that thing, and it's obedience, because the word accord means to be in agreement or be harmonious. It said it opened to his accord, meaning God. When you're obedient to God, the gate will open. But when you're not obedient, you're still in bondage. And we're going to talk about Samson, because Samson was a Nazarite, right? Judges 16:13, it started 13, though. Mm-hmm. I ain't going to do it all. Did I say that right? Nazarite?
That's close.
Nazarene.
Nazarene.
Nazarene, meaning that from birth that he was he had a purpose, that he was devoted to God for a purpose from birth. And that purpose was he was to judge the Philistines. And he did it. But all through Samson's life, he had one problem. He was a womanizer. And he did what God wanted him to do, but he didn't, he wasn't obedient to God in his Nazarite vow, because he didn't supposed to touch anything clean, unclean, anything dead, or eat anything off the vine, or shave his head, but he violated all those. But still, God was with him. You know.
Well, that goes to show you that God will love you no matter what kind of person you are and whatever you did.
Right. But it caught up with
him. Oh, it always will catch up with you.
Yeah.
you can't get away.
He proved that with Paul. Paul was killing all the Christians because that was the way he was raised. He thought he was doing the right thing. And he just kept killing and killing. And to the Lord, you know, brought him to the light and asked him why you persecute me.
Mm-hmm. Samson, he tried to take a wife from the Philistines, but he went home and told his mom them, and he came back and his best friend had him. And he was mad, he caught some foxes and burned up their corn and killed them. People of Israel came against him. They came against the people of Israel. And, you know, Samson did this, and they wanted to bound him. See, his whole life they tried to bound him. They bound him, but the Lord came upon him and he shook it. You know, and all his life until Delilah, he played with his sin. He was on her knee and he told her where his strength lied. But his strength ain't lying in his hair. We know his strength came from God. And so they shaved his head off, and God departed from him, and they bound him. And they put his eyes out. They took him to Gaza, and they bound him with the brass. See, Samson, for 20 years,